Good morning. So good to see you here this morning. Thank you for being here to worship with us. To those of you worshiping online, thanks for joining us. Remember to check in on Facebook and let us know how many are worshiping with you. We love the interaction, so always leave your comments. I don't think we have any announcements today, right? Nothing. Just a normal Sunday. May the peace of Christ be with you. So we know that our community is coming back with cases, and I know anxieties are up and worries, but God is in control, amen, church? So today, let's worship him like he is still on the throne as he is. So stand up and let's sing this first song, reminding us that our living hope is only Jesus Christ, amen?
Desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. Is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a
Jesus, yours is the victory.
awesome God.
Amen.
So let's go on to, let's come before him, humble ourselves, ask God to come into this place. As we come into your presence, Lord, we are here to worship you. All right, every voice.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart.
A few prayer concerns. Lawrence Hastings, who is a former pastor at Methodist pastor at Copeland and also is Esther Walker's brother-in-law, passed away this past Friday. So let's keep him, keep his family in our prayers. Lord, in your mercy. Kara Dunn is feeling under the weather and we want to pray for her healing. So Lord, in your mercy. Also, Phyllis Hasty, who is our district superintendent's wife, missed a step and broke her ankle. So we want to keep her in our prayers. Lord, in your mercy. Are there any others you would like to lift up? Okay. If you'll bow your heads and join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks, Lord, for allowing us to come together to worship you. Lord, we pray for those, for the family that is left behind as our brother has passed on. Be with them, Lord. Give them comfort. Give them peace and let them find their joy in you. For those who are hurting, who have sick bodies, Lord, we lift them up to you. Bring healing, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And Lord, as our community is up in anxiety again, I pray that your peace will just come over us, that we will be reminded that you are in control. And God, we also pray for rain. We need it, Lord. I pray, Lord, in the double meaning also, open up the heavens and wet our land. But also, Lord, open up the heavens and pour your Holy Spirit on to this church, to this community. Lord, we know that you are working. You continue to do good work. And we want to open our hearts to you and let the Holy Spirit move. Let us be bold in our faith, Lord. Continue to strengthen us. And Lord, we come together now with one voice and pray together as you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory forever. Amen. I want to thank you all for supporting our ministry. I want to remind you that you can always mail those into our church. You can give online. And for those of us present today, remember we have our boxes out in the foyer. And drop your tithings and offerings there. All right, let's continue to worship. Shame. Our scripture today is from Acts chapter 4, verses 27 through 31. For in this city, in fact, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place. And now, Lord, look at their threats, and grant to your servants to speak your word with all boldness, while you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. When they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God with boldness. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
All right, kiddos, it's your turn. Come on up.
All right. Well, good morning. How is everyone today? Are we good? Okay, so everybody up here has a card, right? Do y'all have a card? You guys get to keep it. Hold on to it, Eli. It's a magic card. You're going to want to know what it's about here in just a minute. So today, I brought a gift. I put it in this beautiful, fancy box. Do you like my box? It's so sparkly and glittery, I know. Everybody will just love that. So I thought for a really long time today, what would be the very best gift for my friend? And so I came up with what I think is the best gift ever. Like in all of the times and all of the gifts that was ever put in a box, I have the best one. So I put it in there and I got so excited this morning. I cannot wait to give it to my friend because I know that this gift in that box will make their entire day better. You know what? Actually, I think it'll make their whole entire life better. Does that sound like a pretty cool gift? Why is no one excited about my gift? You all look like you're sleeping. So, okay, at least, is anybody curious? Maybe, are you curious who my friend is? You curious? You want to know? All right, well, my friend that gift is for is the friend that has the yellow dot in their hand. Who has the yellow dot? Jovi. Jovi, you are my friend. I love you so much, honey. Well, guess what? This gift right here is for you, but I'm a little worried. You want to know why? Like, I'm kind of worried that you might not like this gift as much as I do. Like, I feel like I may have set it up a little bit too high, and then if you open it, you might not like it. Or maybe you might make fun of me if you don't like what's inside. What if she thinks I'm stupid for what I put in that box? Man, what if she doesn't want to be my friend anymore after she opens the gift and sees what's inside? You know what, Joby, I'm sorry. I love you. I can't risk it. I can't. I have so much anxiety. I don't want this gift in this box to be the thing that changes our friendship forever. So I'm sorry. I'm just going to keep it to myself and we're going to move on. Is that okay? Joby's like handling it really well. Some of the rest of your faces are like, I'm so glad I didn't have the yellow dot. Yeah? Well, how do you think that Joby's feeling right now? For reals. She's a good sport, but what would you guys be feeling if I did that to you? Would you be disappointed? Thanks for the adults for answering, because the kids out here are saying nothing. Well, maybe you'd be a little bit disappointed. And you know what, Joby, I don't want you to feel that way. So I'm going to let you go ahead and go up and open it. Would you prefer I bring it to you? Okay, I know who you are. Another one that doesn't like to stand up in front of everybody. Give your mom a hug when you get back with that. All right, what's in there? A Bible. Well, I think that's the very best gift in the whole world, because in that Bible is the answers to so many things that we need. I hope that you're going to dive right into it or maybe share it with someone else. I think that's pretty, pretty awesome. But you know what? Sometimes we all forget that we have that same kind of gift right inside of us. I don't think any one of us that's up here or maybe even out there would pretend that we know the Bible from cover to cover, but we know who Jesus is. And we know that it's important to choose to follow him. And we can give that same amazing gift every time we share our faith and our relationship with Jesus with other people. All we have to do is tell others about him. But you know what? A lot of times we start to do exactly what I did with that box. We start to worry about what someone might think if we start talking about Jesus. We worry that maybe they'll get mad or they'll think bad things about us. And then we let that fear keep us silent. We let that fear stop us from sharing that good news about Jesus that would change their lives. We know how important it is, and we still let that fear stop us. And I bet every single person in this room, every single person listening on Facebook is guilty of doing that at one time or another. And I know I am absolutely one of them. Today, Pastor Todd's going to talk to us about being bold for God. So bold doesn't mean that you have to be loud or aggressive or ugly or anything like that. When we share that good news, we should always do it in a kind and respectful way. And we should know that God's going to help us with that. God's going to give us that courage to find the words that we need to be able to share and use those opportunities to give our gift to other people. It's not our job to make someone believe. It's not our job to drag someone to church. It's just our job to tell them about who Jesus is and invite them and encourage them to get to know him. God is absolutely going to do the rest. So I have something up here on the screen. We're going to switch over there. And it's a really cool way for us to remember what being bold is like. So let's look up there. How to be bold for Christ. So the B, believe God will give you the words to say. Obey. Obey God's command to tell others. The L is for loving others. That is what compels us. And D, depend on the Holy Spirit to power you. So we don't have to do this on our own, guys. The Holy Spirit's in there, and he's going to give us that strength to be bold. So who are we going to go out and tell about Jesus? Everyone, absolutely. Where's that gift at so we can have that gift? It's right inside of us, right? So we're going to be strong, we're going to be bold for Jesus, and we're going to share that good news with everyone we meet. Go ahead and pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come to you today to pray for strength and courage to be bold in our world. We know that we often let you down, and we are more worried about how others will react to our news than how you will feel about us failing you by being silent. We pray that we will follow your command to be bold and help others to know you. Amen. You guys can head back to your seats. Thank you. Yep, you keep it.
Sam, that was terrific. Hey, did you, you got that I was getting excited a while ago.
I did.
Right?
I did.
So, and did you write that bold thing? Did you come up with that?
I did not.
You didn't? Well, it was really good and it was extremely appropriate. So, everybody turn around, just look at the TV right here on the back. Okay? Normally it'll show kind of the same thing, but we can make it show any one of our inputs, and we can make this one show any of our inputs, and it's kind of a cool little deal. And Levi's up there in control of it, and Levi is one of the best tech people that we have. And guess what that monitor is called? Anybody know? It has a name. It's called Confidence. It's called a Confidence monitor. And it was really interesting because today, when I was, did anybody see me getting excited up here and worried that things weren't going right? Did you see that? Because we were supposed to have picture in picture because we're still trying to do the thing for everybody on Facebook and anybody watching on media. And just through feedback and what we're able to do, they like to see that there's some people in the room and not just a static screen or just a screen just with words. And so they like to see the band moving and we like to see Arabella dancing. Right? And she'll never come back again now that I've said that. So, but we just like to see some movement. But I didn't see the picture-in-picture here. I didn't turn around and look, and it wasn't on that one. And I got real excited about that. And I was like, I got to keep playing. And then Sam, she figured out Pastor's wigging out for something. And she finally, she stood up. Did you guys sit back in the back? She goes, "It's on!" Like, she said it that loud but silently. And here's what I was thinking about. Is, and the thing is, I have confidence in my tech crew. We work really hard. And everybody just say hi, Ophelia. Ophelia stepped in to help us. We got some people out of town today, and she does a fantastic job. And her and Diana stepped up in big ways. We've got a wedding this afternoon. So if you guys see Seth or Nicole, be sure and love on them a little bit. They're getting married today. And but I just want to say, whenever you have confidence, when you have confidence, you can move through some things and you can do that in a bold way, exactly like what Samantha was saying. That was one of the most brilliant and spot on. Not that any of them are not, but that one just especially was very, very terrific word for children. And I hope you got it. How many of you got it? Not enough of you. I'm going to go ahead and preach then. One of these days you guys are going to catch on. But it's just this. If I didn't have... I demonstrated a lack of confidence in my tech crew, that they knew what to do and they knew how to make sure everything was going on. And whenever I didn't demonstrate confidence in my tech crew, guess what? I got excited. I got worried. I got anxious. I was worried that whatever could go wrong would go wrong, that something was going wrong. Now, just keep that in mind, okay? So now for my tech crew, I love you guys. You're doing a fantastic job. And forgive me for that lapse in confidence. And it's going to have a huge bearing on what we do today. And I'm going to ask whoever's in charge of the computer, might get ready to put that scripture up again, okay? Because I just realized that I've set my Bible in the back and don't have it, but that's okay. That word I've hidden in my heart, am I not sinning against thee? How many of you caught the sermon last week? Hey, pretty good, all right? So we're working through the book of Acts, and I don't know. We may be in this book of Acts for the next 5 years. But it's pretty exciting because it's people just like you and I, people who have said yes to Jesus, who have said, I want to follow the resurrected Jesus, right? And so last week we caught up with Peter and John, and after the church is born, Peter's been restored. He's preaching with power of the Holy Spirit. Thousands of people are coming to the Lord daily because of the church's witness. How many people have you led to the Lord in the last 2 years? Listen to the sermon, please, and ask God to speak to your heart. Would you do that? All right? Because there really is something for the church here. There really, I mean, it's everything for the church here. So Peter and John are making their way to worship. They're going up for prayers, just like good Jewish people do. They were going to pray. They're going into the temple. They see a guy crippled from birth, and he asked for money. They said, got none of that, but what I've got for you, I give you in the name of Jesus. The guy gets healed. He's over 40 years old. He's dancing. How many of you men are over 40 years old? You'll stand up and dance for a little bit? Didn't think so. But can you imagine if you had never ever walked in your life? The reason you don't want to stand up and dance now is because you're either tired, you're lazy, or you're afraid of making a fool out of yourself, and my guess is it's the latter. But can you imagine if you hadn't walked ever in your life, and all of a sudden in the name of Jesus, you're up? Tell me how many of you then would be afraid to dance through these aisles? None of you. I hope none of you would be ashamed to dance in these aisles. But here's the truth. All of you walked in here today, didn't you? I'm telling you, use that power while you got that power to use your energy and your body for the Lord. One of these days it'll be gone. That was a little side note. That was for free. Everybody say thank you, Todd. They go in and they get arrested. They get in some trouble. If you guys remember this, remember the religious leaders were annoyed. The Bible says greatly annoyed by them because they had healed. They saw a demonstration of God's power. Remember the show and tell sermon? Remember the proclamation accompanied by demonstration? Demonstration accompanied by proclamation? That you can't just live a good enough life. You need to talk about the life that you're trying to live. Because let me just go ahead and say, none of you are living a stinking good enough life that people are coming to Jesus. Can anybody agree with that? Huh? People aren't flocking to Jesus just because you're living such a great life. And if you did, then you would have to confess, it is by works that I'm good enough. And none of us can do that. That's completely against the scripture, and so you know. So everybody just say, yeah, I'm capable of being a sinner. Right? But somehow, God still wants to use you. God still wants to use me to proclaim this gospel of love, of grace, and of salvation. Come on, church, say amen. All right? So, they get in trouble, they get arrested, they get really just kind of a slap on the wrist from the religious guys that know best, right? Who are annoyed by this preaching about salvation through Christ and about the resurrection of the dead. And they get slapped on the wrist, and so they go back and they go back to the church. Peter and John begin to tell whoever they went back to the others, it says, and they begin to tell them what happened. So you can imagine this. Guys, where you been? We thought you were just going for prayer. That was yesterday. What's up? You ain't gonna believe this. We're going in, some crippled dude there, you know him, you've seen him, you've been there, you've been through the gates. Well, he got healed in the name of Jesus. Woo! And people started gathering around going, what up? And we told them what up. We told them Jesus is what up, not us. Not our righteousness, not in our name, not in any of that stuff, but in the name of Jesus, this cat stood up and he did a boogie woogie like you ain't seen a boogie woogie. And the people at church didn't care for his boogie woogie at church. All you Methodists are going, that sounds about right. And then we got arrested for it because they were annoyed. We were ticking them off a little bit with our preaching. Told them that salvation is through faith in Christ, that this man was healed by faith in Christ and in the power of Jesus' name, and that there's resurrection from the dead in Jesus' name. Come on, church, you awake? Amen. Right? And so we preached that, and we got busted. And they throwed us in jail, and then they brought us out, and they said, you can't say that no more. You guys stop talking about Jesus. We don't want to hear it. You stop talking about resurrection from the dead. Don't do it. Understand? And then remember what the apostles told them. Remember what Peter and John said? Now, you got to remember, these Pharisees, these Sadducees, these religious leaders, these are religious leaders of the law. Everybody say the law. Do you know what people who study the law are called? Lawyers. These guys are lawyers. And here's what Peter and John said. You decide. You make a decision, you holy ones. You make a decision. Is it better for us to obey you or to obey God? Now, if you're a religious leader of the law, guess what? You just got put in a little pickle. Because you're not going to say, do not obey God, obey man instead. But you understand what they just did. So they said, you can decide for yourselves. This, our business is none of your business. And it's none of our business what you decide. This is on you. But for us, we have walked with Jesus. We have talked with Jesus. We have learned from Jesus. We have experienced the power of Jesus. We've seen miracles. My gosh, we had fish sandwiches that were the best in the world. We watched Lazarus raised from the grave after 3 days and came out and walked. And guess what? We had fish sandwiches with him too. And then we watched you crucify Jesus. And then 3 days later, guess what we saw? We saw Jesus raised from the dead. And he came back. So you figure out, is it better for us to obey you or to obey God? But for us, we can't help it. We can't help it. We can't help but to tell what we have seen and heard. And not only can we not help it, we've been commanded to do it, and we've been empowered to do it. And church, I want to speak to you right here today in Ulysses or wherever you're at, in front of your screen, that same command and that same power given to the apostles some 2,000 years ago is the same power that dwells in you right now. Don't forget it. And I fear that maybe you've forgotten it. Now, how many people have you led to Jesus? That's one thing. But let me ask you another thing. Because you don't always have the guarantee that you actually get to lead somebody to Jesus. You know what I mean? But I can ask you this, and I don't think you have to answer me, but I think you have to answer. How many people have you shared Jesus with? That's what you need to be responsible for, guys. You're not off the hook. This isn't a religious duty. It's what it means to follow Christ. You got that? What it means to follow Christ is, are you sharing Jesus' love with people? Are you somehow using your words to share the love of Jesus? And that's what they said. Even in spite of threat, all of this kind of stuff, we have to tell. We have to share. It's what God desires, and it's what God has empowered us to do. Got it? Got it?
Amen.
Got it? Say it. Say you got it. I don't need you to get it because I don't need your kudos. You need to say it because you need to understand that you get it. Right? You got to have this confidence in God, not confidence in anything else, not confidence in the flesh. And so they go back and they tell the church all that has happened. And here's what the church says. Oh, dear. Oh, no. Well, that's too bad. Because we thought we had a mission from God, but golly, we sure don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. We sure don't want to upset anybody. We certainly don't want to impose our opinions on somebody or impose our spirituality on somebody. And now, golly, if there's a chance we're going to get in trouble too, we better just hang out here where it's safe. Is that what the church said? No, you got to understand, because that did not change the mission of God. That did not change the message of God, and it did not change the commission God gave to every believer in Christ. You understand that what people think about it and what people say about it and how people respond about it doesn't change God's mind and God's mission? Do you understand that, church? The mission is still God's mission. And if it ain't your mission, you need to rethink your spiritual connection with God. That's not what the church said at all. They didn't say, oh no, I'm going to get in trouble. Oh my, I'm all wearied now that somebody get their feelings hurt. I'll lose friends on Facebook if I start telling about Jesus. Here's what they said. They went back and they said, listen, there is a message, there is a mission, there is a commission for us. There is empowerment by the Holy Spirit. And so we don't have any options. Church, today you have to understand you don't have any options. If you're in the church, it's option to obey God or not. That's it. Got that? I mean, it gets pretty cool if you opt in for that. It's pretty awesome. And so they said, listen, we've got to tell. We can't keep shut up about this. And do you understand it's not just the 12 now, and it's not just the 120 that we read about in Acts, But you understand, we read in Acts that on one day there were over 3,000 saved, and another day there were over 5,000 saved. We got a big church going on here, about 8,000 people that are saying, no way, we cannot be quiet about this. And do you know all of those 8,000 people? Pretty good chance all of them did not experience Christ the way that that smaller group did. But they came to believe. Amen? And so the deal is, some of the people that you go preach to, some of the people you go witness to, maybe they'll be like, they're religious and they don't care, and they want you to shut up and they don't want to hear about it. But do you understand, in just two sermons, over 8,000 people got saved? Because Peter wasn't dwelling in the past from his sins and his denial of Jesus. Peter was living in now, in the power of God's Holy Spirit that lives in him, that empowered him, that lives in you also, church. And he said, you got to know about Jesus. Here's the deal. And people came to Christ. People came to Christ because of that. And so we just got no options. We have just no options. And I'm glad, I'm really, really glad that Sam said what she said and showed us that boldness. And we're going to talk about that again. In fact, in just a minute, I might have you put that up, okay? But here's what the church said. They said, let's pray. Let's have a prayer meeting. We got some resistance for this gospel. We got some resistance against God's mission. Let's have a prayer meeting. Come on, church. Anybody in here pray? And here's what they prayed. Oh, Lord, let us not offend anyone. No. They said, God, you've commanded us to be witnesses. Help us to be bold. Fill us with your Holy Spirit that we might be bold. Think about what that might mean for you. God, fill me with your Spirit because this flesh is, it's just what it is. And it's not enough. But if I'm filled with the divine Holy Spirit, empowering Spirit of God, what's impossible for me? Nothing. What's impossible? Nothing. And so that's what they prayed. Let's have a prayer meeting. God, fill us with your Holy Spirit so that we may do your mission, but we may do it boldly. Now, I want you to be really, really careful that bold doesn't mean loud. You don't have to yell at somebody. Yelling at somebody, Mike Woolley, park your car in the next spot. That's not bold. That's just being rude. Manipulating somebody. That's not being bold. Listen, those things, those are just being bullies. You don't have to do that. I mean, I don't think anybody expects you to stand up on the table at the donut shop and say, I'm going to tell you about Jesus. You know, I mean, I don't. That has nothing to do with boldness. But having boldness is simply this, is having confidence in what God promised you as a believer. Say it with me. Having boldness means having confidence in what God has promised. Boldness is confidence in God. Say it again. Boldness is confidence in God. And the reason some of us aren't bold is because we are not confident in God. We're worried about ourselves. And guys, are your works good enough? No. But if you offer yourself to Christ and are empowered by Christ's Spirit, what can happen then? What can happen? Anything. Here I am, God, use me. You guys sing that pretty little song. Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I'm not making fun of the song. I'm making fun of you. But here's what I'm getting at. Is every time we sing that song and we go, here am I, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I always want to go, yeah! It is you! And just keep moving until God stops moving you. Right? I don't know if I should. Yes, you should. Just go. Go until God says no. I used to get offers to co-preach. Used to. and And I used to go, well, let me just seek the Lord on it, see if I should go. And that's a good thing. I mean, I think that's a good thing to pray. But then I got to thinking, God, I grew up, and after you called me into ministry, I got to saying, God, wherever you send me, I will go. And so if there's an open door, I just need to pray, God, are you shutting this door? Because it's open, I'm going. I'm going unless you shut this door. Because if there's an opportunity to preach, if there's an opportunity to minister, if there's an opportunity to share, I'm going to take every opportunity that I possibly can to go and to do that. Let me see what my notes say here. Hebrews 13:6. This will give you some idea about biblical boldness. About biblical boldness. And Hebrews 13:6 says, "The Lord is my helper." Anybody? Amen. Can anybody pray that today? Can you say it with confidence? The Lord is my helper. I will not fear. Can you say that? If God is your helper, what do you have to fear? Now, each one of those statements are followed by semicolons. You know what the next one is? What can man do to me? The Lord is my helper. I won't fear what you think. What can that do to me? I won't fear if you defriend me on Facebook. What's that matter? I won't fear if you don't invite me to your birthday party. I'm not going to worry about it. That's not my concern. That's none of my worries. I'm not going to be concerned if you think that I'm a religious idiot or a Bible thumper. Not if I'm coming to you in love. Not if I'm coming to you in the grace of Christ. Not if I'm coming to you in the power of the Holy Spirit. Not if I'm coming to you in the confidence that God will give me the words to speak to you. And aren't all those things God promised? Church, are they? Then my question again is, do you have confidence in God's promises or not? I mean, you can't like answer one without believing in the other, and you can't believe in one without giving an account for how you're living. The Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? What's the worst that can happen? Are you worried about getting thrown in jail? No. You worried about getting slapped on the wrist? What are you worried about? What are you worried about? And then Ephesians 3:12 says, we are bold with confidence through faith in Christ. Anybody have faith in Christ? Amen. We're bold with confidence because of our faith in Christ. Not in me, not in myself, not in my flesh, not in my own words, not in my own vocabulary, my own vernacular, not in my own testimony. I'm bold because what Christ has done. I'm bold because I have faith that everything that Christ has promised is real deal. And that's what faith is. That's exactly what faith is. 2 Corinthians 3:12. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold. And bold, bold has nothing to do with the volume of your voice. It has nothing to do with it has nothing to do with being forceful. It has nothing to do with any of that stuff. Although sometimes boldness, you may speak and with some authority, and you might do that. But the thing is, boldness is moving through every fear. Boldness is moving through every obstacle. Boldness is moving ahead in obedience to Christ. How many of you have ever prayed, God, just let me be a vessel for you? Anybody? You prayed, there's a few hands going up. God, yes, use me. Let me be a vessel for you. And if you think about vessels and you think about maybe an ocean-worthy vessel, whenever you say vessel, you don't get to choose the condition of the sea. You see what I mean? Let me be a vessel of you. Okay, there's some rough waters. I want you to pedal through those. But do you have to do it in your own power? No. You said, let me be a vessel for God. Then who will fuel you? Who will empower you? Who will move you? Right? It'll be God who does that. It'll be God who does that. And that's good stuff. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold. Think about this. I'm not going to browbeat. I'm not going to manipulate. I'm not going to coerce. I'm just going to lay a few things out. And if you want to answer them verbally, you're welcome to answer them verbally. If you want to cherish them in your heart, you're welcome to do that. If you want to update your Facebook page and make your shopping list, you can do that. You can do whatever you want to do right now, okay? Fair enough? But I hope you'll pay attention. That's my hope. Because what I really believe is the Holy Spirit wants to move through the people of this church. That's what I believe. Anybody else praying for that? Yes. Big spiritual boot and the spiritual short pants right now. Spiritual, Rob. I don't need a kick in the hind end from you, buddy. Well, maybe I do. I just don't want one. Is Jesus your Lord and Savior? Think about it. I mean, think about it. Do I just need Jesus as a Savior? Or is Jesus my Lord? Because if Jesus is really going to be your Savior, He really needs to be your Lord. And if Jesus is your Lord, that means it's not all about you, it's all about Him. Remember that prayer we all prayed before? Whose kingdom? Thy kingdom come. Your, right? Not like my kingdom. Right? That's not how it works. Are God's promises true?
Yes.
Think about it. Do you believe in God's promises? And you may not know all of the promises. I mean, Samantha shared that with us. Not all of us know that Bible front to back. Or some of you do. I don't know. I don't. I've been through it a bit. I mean, are God's promises true? If God says, I will meet all of your needs, not once, I'll meet all of your needs according to my riches and glory, meaning I'll meet your needs in a spiritual, heavenly way, is God true? Do you have confidence that that promise is true? You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Do you have confidence that that promise is true? I will teach you what to say when you stand before people. Is that promise true? Are God's promises true? I mean, there's so many. I mean, we want the ones that you will be forgiven whenever you confess and you will spend eternity with me in heaven. How many of you believe that's true? Right? Come on. Are you looking forward to eternity? I mean, maybe not this afternoon, but... Are God's promises true? Does the Holy Spirit dwell within you? Don't have to ask you if you feel it. But remember, our walk is by faith. But if God says that you can only say that Jesus is Lord by the Holy Spirit, you know that the Holy Spirit seals you, and then you know that there are times God fills you with the Holy Spirit. There's a refreshing infillment. There's infillment for special things. You might be in a dry place, in a dry land, and you might be able to just be dry spiritually. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Have you ever felt dry spiritually? Just felt maybe bankrupt spiritually? Do you know there's times then whenever you just avail yourself to God and say, God, fill me with your Spirit. And there's that. And do you believe that that's true? Do you believe that God will do that, will empower you with His Holy Spirit? Do you trust by faith what God says to believers? And so you have to make up your mind. Do you trust what God says? And if you can affirm that, then if you truly believe, you have confidence. Amen? That you can answer. If you truly believe, you have confidence. Amen?
Amen.
I know Lawrence, the man that we prayed for his family who just passed away. Just last week or maybe 2 weeks ago, he was given about 3 months to live. I know Lawrence. He was a pastor and he was an amazing, beautiful person. He had confidence in the Lord. He was ready to go meet Jesus. I don't know that he was whistling zippity-doo-dah that it would happen this quick, but he was ready. He had confidence in God. He had confidence. And so you stop and think about whenever you have confidence in God, you don't have to be a bully. You just move through in the power of God. Did Jesus ever bully people? He just said, here's heaven. It's pretty cool. Come check it out. You're welcome. You're welcome to come check it out. You're welcome to come be a part of it. I mean, that was Jesus' ministry. How many of you can do that? Every one of you. Every one of us can do that. And if you have no confidence in Christ, then I have to say, where's your faith? Well, I just don't know that God will. Then you don't have any confidence in the promises of God, because God said that He would. But you got to understand, you have to take that step of faith. You have to move into it. You have to open up your pie hole and see what the Lord will do with it. You have to begin to take those steps of faith. How many of you would say in your life you've taken a step of faith for something? I've written letters, I've sent texts, I've made phone calls, I've done things, I have bought things, I've sold things, I've given things away, I have shared things with people, I have given people different services and all that, kind of all in steps of faith. And do you know that most of the time I don't feel any reward for that? And some of the time I wonder if I missed it. Was I supposed to have done that? Should I have said that? And a lot of times I second guess after the fact. But here's where I always go back to. I believe that God cares most of all that I'm faithful. I believe God cares that I'm faithful. He can work with the rest. But if you're unwilling to take a step of faith, God's not going to work with that much. I was so honored by you sitting on your butts doing nothing that I decided to come to church again. And work that way. If you have confidence in God's promises, confidence in God's word, you have faith in Christ, guess what, church? You can be bold. You can be bold. Bold to be a witness for Christ. Bold because of your confidence in God. Bold because of your confidence that the Holy Spirit lives and dwells. You know what that means? Makes His home with you. You can have confidence in that. Not in your flesh. You get to blame everything on Jesus. You have confidence in Christ. I want to share one last thing. It didn't make my notes, but I think the Lord wants me to share it. I know from speaking with so many people over decades of ministry that many, many people who shrink back from being a witness for Christ do that because of some personal concern, some excuse that begins with, because I. And it might be this, because I don't know what to say, because I'm not holy enough, because I don't think I live a life worthy that they could really, you know, because I don't think the message of Jesus Christ and my own performance lives up to it. Can anybody here relate to that? Yes, just say yes out loud. I can't see your nods, right? Okay, I can't hear your nods. Right, yes. So I'm not off target on this. But I want you to think about this, that also, God didn't call us and appoint us and empower us to go point out people's sins. Somebody say, whoo, thank God. That conversation might come up, but that was never the mission. The mission was to go preach forgiveness in Jesus' name. Preach salvation through Jesus' name. Do you get that? That was the mission. You'll be my witnesses, not my judges. Got it? And I got to thinking about how this can kind of turn around a little bit, and I'm going... I mean, can you, just by a grunt, can you say, I don't think my life, my holiness, lines up with God's will for my holiness? Anybody can go, yeah, kind of agree with that. But you think about a world that doesn't know Jesus, do they have sins? Just like you? Yes? But see, here's the difference. Without our testimony, they stand condemned in their sins because they haven't heard about the salvation, forgiveness, love, acceptance of Jesus Christ, the message that was entrusted to us. Do you see? Do you get that? And so as far as us standing being more holy than people in the world, I don't know that any of us would say, yep, better than that person. Okay, maybe you might. But You get the idea? The thing is, we take all of our sins to Christ. And what does Christ do with those? Paid for them. Remember that thing back there at Calvary? Remember that stuff on the cross? It's all covered. Got it. And I welcome you into the kingdom of heaven. Here's what I'd like you to do, is I'd like you to bring some others. I'd like you to share this story with some others. So the difference between us and other people is that we have somebody to stand in the gap whenever we have to stand before God, and they don't. And that's why that witness is so important. And I hope that there's not a relative that you have, that you love, that you care about. I hope that there's not a friend or a coworker that at some point you won't be saying, God, will you open up that door so that I might be able to share? I'm not doing any of this on my own holiness anyway. Amen? Amen. I'm not. Guys, I don't stand before you because I think I'm anything. I told Tara before the service, I said, I never step down from behind the pulpit. I mean, I don't use a pulpit, the proverbial pulpit. I never step down thinking, wow, I'm a good preacher. I never, ever have said that. Never have thought that. But I step down going, God, I hope I was faithful to the word that I believe the Holy Spirit brought to me to share. And I hope for each one of you that you'll do that too. And I hope there's nobody in your life that you wouldn't say, I got to at least try. I got to at least step out. And God has given me the Holy Spirit, and I believe in God's promises. Amen? Amen? God has empowered me, and I believe in God's empowerment. Amen? Amen? I don't have to do this on my own. I do this in God's power. Amen? I don't have to do it in my name. I do it in God's name. Amen? I don't do it because I think it's a great thing to do, because it's really sometimes an uncomfortable thing to do, but I do it because God has commanded me to do it. Amen? Amen. Yep. Well, then go have some fun. Is everybody going to love you because of it? Nope. Somebody might hate you because of it. I don't know. Probably not. I'm with her. Right? We just have that confidence in what God has done with each one of us. Church, that's what it's going to take for us to wake up. That's what it's going to take for God's mission to be done. That's it. And I don't know if we're living in the last days. I'm seeing all kinds of last days, coronavirus prophecies, and all of this stuff going on. But those are things that I've heard 20 and 30 years before with different things going on around them. So I don't know. Jesus taught us something about that. He said, no one knows except God. So I don't know. But you want to know what's the same? The mission. You want to know what's the same? God's promises. You know what's the same? God's word. You know what's the same? God's mission. You know what's the same? God's commission. And you know what's the same? God uses us knuckleheads to do all that. Amen? Amen. See, not everybody said amen. God wants to use us in God's mission. Amen. And my guess is that really, in all sincerity, I think maybe some of us need to take time and just pray and say, God, forgive me. I have let my flesh, I've let my own excuses, I have let my own perceived reputation, I've let my own knowledge, I've let my own limited knowledge, I've let something, anything else, hinder me from being a witness for you, from sharing your love, your grace, your love, forgiveness. So God, have mercy on me and forgive me for being silent, because you've not called us into silence. You've not called us into being timid. You have not called us into a ministry that shrinks back from the gospel. But Lord, let me be bold. Let me be confident in your promises. Let me be confident in the power of the Holy Spirit, not in my own flesh, not in my own knowledge, not in my own words. Let me be confident in you, God. Desire that, church? Yes. Let's stand, let's sing. Oh, it's as we go.
Get it together, Pastor.
We practiced the blessing, though, whenever you went upstairs.
Okay, let's try again.
I don't have it. I don't have it nearby. I do have it.
He has no confidence
this
in me.
This is not awkward for me at all. I'm okay.
I know I put it on there.
Tanya's got it. Oh, she's playing the blessing too.
Yeah.
We're going to sing the blessing.
Sing the blessing.
You guys know this. We don't even need it up.
No scream.
I pray that the Lord will bless and protect you, and that He will show you mercy and kindness. May the Lord be good to you and grant you peace. And may His face shine on you.
Yes.
May His face shine on you. May His face shine on you. And may God the Father, the Son, and the Spirit remain with you. Amen. Amen. Big Finish Church. So be here we go.
Amen.
All right, say this. The Holy Spirit lives in me.
Holy Spirit.
God's power dwells in me.
God's power dwells in me.
God has called me to be His witness.
God has called me to be His witness.
And I have confidence.
And will be bold for God.
Amen.
Amen.
Now get out of here and go do it.